Hello all, in this presentation we are going to see about clinico-social case pro forma. The clinico-social case pro forma format which is described in this presentation is given in the link below from which you can download and you can use it in your own settings. If you haven't subscribed to the ThinkLateral channel, please subscribe. So before going to the clinical case study pro forma individually, these are all the headings. Patient demographic details, family details, clinical details, socio-environmental details, physical examination and management. The usual history, examination and management, that is investigations and treatment, is the typical clinical case pro forma. Here it is called as clinico-social case pro forma because the social component of the disease or the illness has been added, enquired, and we add preventive measures for the disease, and we will give suggestions not only for the individuals but also for the family and the community. So, patient demographic details, we have name, age, gender, marital status, religion, education, address, occupation, date of admission, OPIP, number, ward number, total number of family members. Name, when you should know the name clearly, when you present in front of the examiner, if you mention the name by Mr. X or Mr. Y, then the examiners will be impressed. Wherever possible, if you call by name, the rapport will be developed with the patient. And wherever this age, gender and marital status and all, these are all the factors which predispose certain diseases and the disease severity also. The education, occupation, literacy and all are the important factors in determination of the socioeconomic status of the family. These other particulars will help in identifying the patient. Then we have total family members. So if we ask the total family members in socio-demographic details, then this family details we have to add the each family number details by name. So we have to add X, Y, Z like this. So age, gender, and also what is the relationship to the index case or to the head of the family, what is the education, what is the occupation, what is the monthly income, what is the immunization status in case of children, what is the health status in case of adult. So we have to ask about the type of the family, whether it is the nuclear family, joint family or a three generation family. Nuclear family is the family when the husband and wife live with their own children. When the husband and wife live with their children and with their brothers and their parents, that is called a joint family. When three generations, that is husband and wife, their father and mother and their children live together, then that is called as a three generation family. In India nowadays, nuclear family is the most commonest type. So you can draw the family tree here, which can be drawn by representing the females by circle and males by square. If you join them horizontally, then it indicates they are married to each other. And when you connect a male and a female from above, which means they are siblings. So this is exactly how to draw a family tree. So you can draw the write the age inside, so that you can convey more information through this family tree. So if you, this is your case, you can mark an index arrow and then you can mark the case like this. And if suppose the person, if this is a three generation family, then we have to add like this. So if there is mother is living, means you can add like this. And if the father is not there, then you can strike it off. There are various codes in family tree so that you can convey lots of information. And this represents the basic family tree. You have to ask vital events in the family in the past 1 year, that is birth and death, marriage or divorce, you have to ask the total family income per month, which is divided by the total family members, will yield per capita monthly income. So which will help in the modified BG Prasad's classification for the socioeconomic status scale categorization. So we have to calculate the total family income, and the when we divided it by total family number of family members, we will get this per capita income. So socioeconomic scales, which is commonly recommended here, is modified Kuposwami scale in case of urban settings, modified BG Prasad scale in case of rural settings. Actually, modified BG Prasad scale can be used in rural and urban also, but due to the complexity of other scales, and also BG Prasad is not accurate, it is not used in urban but only recommended in rural. The complex scales which can be used in rural are Udai Parikh and SLI scales, that is standard of living index scale. So socioeconomic status is defined in the given slide, that is modified Kuposwami scale for urban, which is determined by income, occupation and literacy, IOL, that is intraocular lens, income, occupation and literacy. So income is here, occupation is here, and education is here. For education, the maximum score is 7, for occupation the maximum score is 10, for income the maximum score is 11. For all this IOL, the minimum score is 1. So based on this, adding all these scores, we will yield a score of maximum of 29 and a minimum of 1. So based on these categories, further we can classify into upper, upper middle, lower middle, upper middle, lower, 1, 2, 3 and 4, or 1, 2, 3 and 4 respectively. So this is the modified Kuposwami scale for urban. Why it is called modified is basically it was calculated in around 1980s. So every year based on this CPI, that is consumers price index, so which is a district specific, and also every week it differs. So based on that recent one we can calculate. So this is the February 2019 calculation. If something comes up in 2020, or you can ask your department faculties to calculate for the recent one using this modified Kuposwami scale and formulas, so they can give you. So now for the rural and urban, but we generally recommend this only in case of rural families. So BG Prasad's scale, which is given by the formula, total family income divided by total family members, that is the per capita income. So based on which upper, upper middle, middle, lower middle and lower classes are classified. So these are all the cutoffs. So again based on the CPI, we can calculate, again based on the CPI, we can calculate the recent BG Prasad's classification. So this is 2019 January 1. So 2020 will come. So wait for that classification. So from we are moving on from socio-demographic details to clinical details. Clinical details, we start with history. History, first and foremost, is the complaint. Complaint is nothing but what for the patient has come to the hospital. What for the patient has come to the hospital is called as the complaint. History of presenting illness is just describing the illness from a normal, apparently normal state to the progress and how he is now. So how he is now. So this exact position is the current situation is explained in the history of illness. So all the positive symptoms has to be described based on this. If suppose we have fever here, then how was the onset, and what is the duration, how it progressed, what was the relieving factors, when it get aggravated. So that has to be there. Then we have to describe the situation. From this we have to tell about the negative history, any significant negative history. So from complaints and history of presenting illness, we have to direct our all our findings towards a particular diagnosis. So for this, negative history is very important to rule out the other diseases. With the history, to rule out complications also. So complications also we have to ask the symptoms. For examples, for example, in dehydration, we can ask for drowsiness. and other for in diabetes we can ask for the symptom severity or grading we can ask. So differential diagnosis and related history can also be ruled out through the history of within the history of presenting illness. Then we are moving to the clinical details. Clinical details, this is the treatment history. We are moving to treatment history, that is before admission, what was the drug taken, what was the dosage and frequency, whether there was any similar illness in the past was present, and we have to ask about the healthcare delivery assessment, what is the nearest health facility available and how far it is present. So that also we need to ask. And during every episode of the illness, what was the response from the patient, that we have to respond in the chronological order, and based on all the symptoms we have to describe where they have gone and what kind of treatment they have taken, based on the place, what is the treatment taken, whether they have, when they have referred, and what was the status of the disease. All these things we have to discuss in clinical details, which is followed by past history. So past history, we have to ask for the certain set of standard diseases which you need to remember. These diseases will always affect the severity of other diseases in other subjects. But in case of community medicine, diabetes mellitus, hypertension and stroke, tuberculosis and all are all cases which can be kept in exams. So that we have to be very careful. We need to ask, that is the importance for asking this past history. So history of drug allergy also should be asked. Family history, so there are two types of family history. Any family history of non-communicable disease like diabetes and hypertension will act as a predisposing factor for that person getting the disease. In case of a communicable disease, this family history will help in the contact tracing of the disease. So moving on to the personal history, here the behavior is targeted, that is alcohol, smoking, tobacco chewing and other high risk factors. Some may include sleep and diet also within the personal history, diet also within the personal history. And in menstrual history, in females, we need to ask the menstrual history, that is menarch and the cycles, which is regularly regular or not, and the frequency, what are all the number of days of bleeding and the number of days of cycle. Then the last one in the clinical details is the diet history. So diet history, we need to describe whether the patient is a vegetarian or a non-vegetarian and what is the staple food which is present. This may be rice, ragi or wheat commonly. Most commonly in our settings it will be rice. So what is the frequency of non-vegetarian per week? What is the frequency of fruits and vegetarian per week? If the frequency is very often, then you can reduce it to per day calculation. Oil usage per month. What is the oil usage per month in the family? Then here you have to tell, according to the 24-hour dietary recall method, you have to tell the patient has consumed in the morning around this time, he has consumed this meal which has yielded this calorie and this protein, and he has taken for the breakfast two idli like this. We have to give the calculation. So totally we need to calculate here and put the daily intake here, and we have to estimate the daily requirement based on the gender, working capacity and the body weight also. So all these things we have to consider, and we have to calculate the energy requirement and substitute the energy requirement and the protein, and we have to mention the sufficiency also, sufficiency or insufficiency, which can be indicated by excess in case of positive sign and negative in case of deficiency. Now we have completed socio-demographic details and clinical details. Now we are moving to family details. Now we are moving to socio-economic, socio-environmental factors. So environment, first and foremost is the housing. So we have to look at whether the house is pakka, kacha or semi-pakka. So which is defined by the good roof and wall, which is wall and floor, then it can be defined as a pakka house. And any house which has a leaking roof and floor will be considered as a kacha house. And any house which has a improper other than concrete and floor impervious, but currently in a good function will be considered as a semi-pakka house. Now we are moving to the overcrowding. Overcrowding can be given by three formulas, three criteria, that is sex separation, number of persons per room, and also number of persons per floor space area. Lighting also, we can ask the patient whether they can be able to read in all the corners and in the center of the house, in all the rooms. Thereby we can assess the lighting of the house and we can say adequate or not adequate. And remember, this is lighting, not lightening. We have to mention about ventilation. Ventilation is given by the criteria based on the floor space area and the window space area, and the floor space area and the window and door space area combined. So ideally it should be the window space should be 1/5 of the floor space area, and the window and the door space combined should be more than 2/5 of the floor space area. That is how we calculate the ventilation. When the windows and the doors face each other, then you can call the cross ventilation is present. Then we have to ask about the water supply. Where is the source? Whether the source is from the well or from the corporation, that you have to ask. And how they are storing that water. What are any household methods of purification they are doing, and whether that water is adequate or not. All these things you should ask. Then we should ask about the latrine facility and whether the latrine is sanitary or not. This sanitary latrine is given by the three criteria. One is the 24 hours water supply. I mean 24 hours water supply. It is not the piped water supply or tapped water supply. There should be water always present 24 hours, which can be either in a bucket or available through the sink. So that is the first criteria. And the second criteria is the presence of the water seal. The purpose of the water seal is to avoid the is to prevent the flies from entering into the septic tank or the into the feces, getting in contact with the feces, and the smell from the feces should not come out. So that is the purpose of the water seal. And the third most important is this sewage should be disposed properly into the sewage treatment plant or a septic tank. So these are all the three criteria to say a latrine sanitary. Then about the solid waste disposal, how they are collecting, what are all the methods followed, how frequently they are collecting, how are they disposing, where are they, what is the site, and how far it is located. So all these things we need to ask when it comes to solid waste disposal. Then kitchen and cooking fuel used, what are all the kitchen fuel used, the kitchen platform, whether it is present or not, type of fuel, and how the raw food and cooked food is stored. Whether a refrigerator is present or not, that and all we should ask. Then whether we should ask about the hand washing practices, whether they are washing before eating, before cooking, and after defecation with soap and water. That we need to ask. And we should ask about the pets in the family. This will help in the predisposing, identifying the predisposition factors for presence of any zoonosis within the family. And also we should ask about the vector breeding sites, whether it is present or not. So then that was about the environmental factors, and this is about the social factors. And these social factors, remember, it cannot be asked as a pro forma. You have to develop a good rapport. You have to explore and speak to the patient when the heart sociology is otherwise called as study of human behavior or psychology. So it's a connect between the two hearts. So you have to develop a good rapport and have a good discussion and explore your objectives. So you need to identify the knowledge, attitude, practice of the patient towards the disease. So what is the attitude of the family towards the patient? What is the attitude of the society towards the patient? Whether there is the health services which is available or not, and the effect of illness, whether there is any financial strains and sociological effects and psychological effects on the family, that we should assess. And after assessing these four important, that is socio-demographic, family, socio-environmental and socio-environmental factors, we need to summarize the history. So this patient is coming from this belonging to the socio-economic status according to DG Prasad's or modified Kopusami's classification of upper middle class, say for example, hailing from this family with complaints of this thing, with a significant medical and socio-environmental history that you should mention. Then we move on to the physical examination as routine. So we say the pickle is the mnemonic, PACCKLE. So pick pallor, ictus, cyanosis, pedal edema, lymph edema, clubbing, pulse, whether it is present, the pulse rate, pulse rhythm, and other characteristics should be mentioned. The blood pressure, as usual as how you present in medicine, you need to present all these things as respiratory rate, weight, height, and BMI, which is calculated by weight divided by height in meter square, weight in kilogram divided by height in meter square. So he weigh hip circumference, waist circumference, and waist hip ratio. This is most important in case of diabetes and hypertension, the other non-communicable disease. Any other general relevant findings in the general examination also should be presented. Then we physical examination is divided into general and systemic examination, where RS and we divide it into system. RS should be of more focus when we have two cases like TB and ARI. When we get that is tuberculosis and acute respiratory infection, then we need to focus more on this RS. Then other systems like CVS and all will be more on hypertension, hypertension, etc. Then CNS, we have when we get leprosy, we need to focus more on CNS. Then abdomen, foot examination in case of diabetes is also very important. We have to look for any ulcers, how the nail is kept, whether it is properly cut and clear. Then cracks is present or not, then color change is present or not, all these things we should observe. Then we should observe for any temperature difference, and the dorsalis pedis artery pulsation and posterior tibial artery can be felt. Then vibration sense also can be checked, which is the first sense to lose in case of all neurological defects. So from here, from history, we have moved on to the examination, and now we have to come to a particular diagnosis. So we have to tell, replace with the complaints with the diagnosed with this, and with the grade, what is the grade of the disease, and any complications is present or not. So that you have to mention. Then when it comes to investigations, we have to mention about routine investigations, and you have to be very careful when you mention routine examinations, investigations. Some examiners are very fond of it. Some examiners are some examiners are offensive towards routine investigations, but most important is this confirmation of the diagnosis. That is, there will be a specific gold standard test for that particular disease, to diagnose that particular disease. That should be mentioned for the confirmation, whether it is already done or which is required. And ruling out the complication, severity you need to assess. So you need to identify the grade and severity. For that you need to do prescribe some investigations. So now this is the management. We have medical and social aspects into it, and every management part is divided into preventive, promotive, and curative measures. Preventive, promotive, and curative measures. So this is, as I told earlier, it is not only at the individual level, but also at the family level and the community level. So at individual level, we have to give the treatment to alleviate the symptoms and to cure the disease, and for and advise, that is, what are all the other non-pharmacological measures which can be done to get out of the illness. So everywhere we have to divide it into three important thing, that is primary prevention, secondary prevention, and tertiary prevention. So every at every level we need to give primary prevention, secondary prevention, and tertiary prevention. So and tertiary prevention. So and in family level and community level and all, you can add one more primordial prevention also. Apart from this, primary and secondary levels. So in family level, we need to identify the any stigma present, and the support what the patient expects, that we need to give to the family. And at the community level, we need to identify the pros and cons which is present in the health program, and what are all the benefits, possible benefits which the patient can get from the government to the patient, that you can mention, and whatever possible nice recommendation you are giving, that intimate it to the patient. Tell to the patient first, then write it in the case sheet, because many examiners nowadays check whether you have told it to the patient rather than writing alone. So these are all the last few slides which has a few additions in antenatal case. So that is whenever you are asking antenatal case, in knowledge attitude practice segment, we need to ask about the awareness and belief of the mother's nutrition, iodized salt intake is there or not, breastfeeding awareness, immunization awareness, vitamin A prophylaxis, family planning method, Anganwadi center where it is located, personal hygiene, warning signs, all these things should be asked. The attitude of the mothers towards pregnancy, attitude of the family towards pregnancy, cultural practices during pregnancy, and utilization of the health services, that we need to know. And we need to know about the obstetric score, that is GPLA. We all can easily say L is the live births, that is total number of live children now, not the live births, it is the live children now. A means abortion, which is less than any day, delivery less than 28 weeks will be considered as abortions. Para means which is any delivery which has crossed more than 28 weeks, any pregnancy will be considered as gravida. So that is G. So EDD is calculated by Neagle's rule, that is adding 9 months and 7 days to the first day of last menstrual period. So thereby we can calculate the EDD. And the additions in antenatal case continues here. So first trimester, second trimester, and third trimester, we need to ask these specific points. That is, first trimester we need to ask what is the time of the registration, and whether morning sickness was present or not, and in the, after the first time of registration, whether any investigations were done or not, and TT was given or not, how many TTs were given, and how many IFAs were prescribed, how many IFAs are taken, that we should account, and any history of drug intake should be asked, because any drug intake during the first trimester will cause serious birth defects, and weight gains should be usually asked in almost all the trimesters, and it will be more significant in third trimester. Then second trimester we should ask about the quickening, that is the perceived fetal movements by the mother for the first time. Then warning signs. Then we should ask about the hours of sleeps and rest what they are taking. Then the antenatal visits, what is the recommended antenatal visits, what in each visit what they are supposed to do, that you have to ask. Then in the abdomen, while inspecting, you need to ask about the linear, inspect the linear Niagara striagravidum and palpate all this fundal height, abdominal grip, everything, pelvic grip, second pelvic grip, the purpose is to identify the gestational age, and you need to see whether the calculated gestational age approximates with the real gestational age, so that you can identify the baby is small for the date or large for the date, and we need to see the fetal heart rate using the fetoscope. So these are all some of the key points in clinico-social case performer. There are all the key points when it comes to clinico-social case performer. Hope this presentation was useful to you. The link for downloading this case performer is given in the description, so you can download. And in the next presentation, we will continue with what are all the additions for the newborns and under 5 child, and the recommendations for each diseases individually, based on the primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention at the individual, family, and the community level. So that will be in the upcoming videos. Till then, you subscribe to the channel, click on the bell icon. All the best. Thank you.